thank you very much. This is a great idea to have a presentation like this. I've done lots of presentations on fire safety and how you conduct fuel reduction, but never really focused on habitat and the wildlife. So this is a first. I thought we would start out with some definitions, because I always get asked, well, what is defensible space? So this is the definition of defensible space. It's reducing the fuel around your property, trying to minimize the transfer of fire from one item to another, something being vegetation, transferring to another piece of vegetation, or transferring from a vegetation to your home. That's really what defensible space is. In some of our brochures and magazines that you see and online, you'll see kind of a more of a complicated structure where they break it down into zones. Zone one being very, very close to your house within the first 30 feet, and zone two moving out more into the back 40, eventually getting to 100 feet or plus on your property. So, what defensible space is not, is this. And I know insurance companies are very persuasive in getting people to try to remove as much vegetation as possible. And I get those phone calls, it gets pretty extreme. I've had insurance companies require up to 1,500 feet of defensible space in Portola Valley. And I really urge you to contact them and then to work with me, and let's try to come up with a happy medium, because they're really pulling those numbers out of the sky. When we do damage assessment in an area that's been hit by fire, most of the time, all the vegetation around the house, the larger trees, are intact. They're a little scorched, but they're intact. The house is gone. What that tells us is the vegetation can be fireproof, but the houses are far, far from it. We have a lot of work to do on how we build our houses. So I had to pull this definition up from the California Wildlife Habitat Relations Program. And habitat is an area that offers feed, roosting, breeding, nesting, and refuge areas for a variety of bird and mammal species. So habitat just isn't cover. Habitat includes a food source. So most of Portola Valley, until you get into the higher elevations, is really considered an oak woodland. And I think it's important to remember and to understand what an oak woodland really should be. And the mayor talked about burning and how this area was burned in previous decades. So an oak woodland is dominantly oak trees. We do have other natives such as buckeye, with an understory of mostly grasses. California oak woodland provides a varied habitat for lots of different animals all over California. And we have all of these, deer, squirrel, turkeys, jays, quail, all here, that thrive in the oak woodland. So what's okay in an oak woodland? Standing dead trees, downed logs are perfectly fine in the oak woodland. If I sat all day long with a torch on the trunk of an oak tree that had fallen, that was standing, I would probably never, never be able to ignite it. It's the underbrush and the grasses that are the flashy fuels that are really easy to ignite. So when I go to people's houses and they say, oh, look at this dead tree, this is a fire hazard, I really don't deem it a fire hazard at all. It's too large of a fuel to burn quickly. So these are perfectly okay to have in the oak woodland. What's happening in our area, however, is that the underbrush is becoming so thick that it will eventually burn, and it will be such hot fuel, 1,000-hour fuel, eventually you will catch those oak trees on fire. So it's our underbrush, not our oak trees, and not necessarily the grass, that really is the problem in our oak woodland. So I just took this the other day. This is right off Alpine Road, and you can see four different pictures here. Islands of brush. There's a dead limb here, provides a nice little habitat, birds and squirrels. This is a very large log that's been around for a while, and it's perfectly safe. So this right here is kind of the look that the fire district is promoting. We're not promoting denuding, we are okay with some dead vegetation, okay with islands of brush. We do require that you do mow grass 4 to 6 inches. And a 4 to 6 inch grass will still carry a fire, but extremely slowly. And time again, we've gone out to grass fires in homes where they've mowed the grass, and we are able to subdue the fire, put the fire out without destroying any homes or really any property. So it works. Mowing works. So I talked about oaks. They are extremely fire resistant. One of the most fire resistant trees I think I've ever seen. Even their leaves and the smaller branches are really fairly hard to burn. Those of you who burn firewood in your fireplace, it takes a lot of heat to get oak going, and it has to be really, really, really dry. The only thing with the oaks is the oaks that are vulnerable or have been killed from the SOD, they are kind of a different story because they are much, much, much drier. And that would be my only really exclusion about oaks not being fire resistant. Some of my slides are slid off here, but what I wanted to show in this picture, and Philippe Cohen knows this picture well because we put it together, both of us, is that our community is changing. This is, and I put on the top of the slide here, invasives are changing everything. And this is Corte Madera School, and the top picture is 1968. The bottom picture is a bunch of cardi brush and some broom and all kinds of stuff that's pretty much filling in. So this was an oak woodland, it was a beautiful meadow. I don't think they burned here, maybe the Indians did, but this was a school. So this is how it was before the invasives took over. And this is what I'm talking about, underbrush. So Scotch and French broom, I hate them. I think the town of Rito Valley is doing a really great job. I know you people are working really hard to pull it from your property and your neighbor's property and the open space, and I can't thank you enough for that. It is extremely vulnerable to fire. It does not provide habitat. I went on the internet and looked for animals and mammals that liked broom, and I really found very few. I think I found wasps. So it's something that is taken over. It was, it's an exotic. It was brought over for its ornamental reasons, and it's got to go back. So, so these pictures, I whispered in Philippe's ear that I had a surprise for him, and he emailed me these pictures just about a week ago, and these are all recent photos from Jasper Ridge, and. My main point here is that these critters love open space. This is where they eat. The bunnies eat this. The turkeys like to eat, in the meadows. The deer love to eat the juicy shoots. So open space, meadows, it's also an important habitat. I understand that everybody's worried about cover and you need brush, and you're right, you do. But here's proof. Philippe has a lot of pictures of critters in the open part of the preserve. So thank you, Philippe, for these photos. So the most important area to clear is within the first 30 feet and then to 100 feet of your home. Like my previous slide, our wildlife does not want to live underneath our kitchen window. They really don't. They want to live in the back 40, usually about 100 feet away from our home. So this works as a perfect balance. If we are doing our vegetation modification 30 feet to 100 feet, and then we're leaving some natural areas after that, I think it's the perfect balance. So again, I really truly feel that leaving some open space in your property is important. We actually had a fire here, and it moved very, very, very slowly up the hill. This individual, I don't know if anybody recognizes, maybe Charlie, this is right off Los Trancos Road, and it's a large, large piece of property, and they use sheep to graze it. And I drive by here quite often, and I have seen more wildlife in this this meadow with these oaks than I think I've seen anywhere else. So how do we implement fuel reduction? So the first thing to do is to do it well before fire season. Bird nesting season is usually from March to August, and so if you're cutting branches and trees and things like that in that period of time, you are interrupting wildlife. So late fall, winter months, that's usually good for the trees and the bushes anyway, because they're you know, they're into their fall mode, their deciduous mode. So you know, keep the oldest and the biggest trees and bushes. That is what the animals like. Plan to remove invasive, non-native plants first. Target those items. These plants are very aggressive, and they will take over your property. And they do not provide good habitat. Plan to treat the native plants last. If you can spare them, that's great. They usually require the least water. Our native animals love them, and they're resistant to weather, insects, etc. If you have a sensitive species on your property, either a plant or an animal, have a conversation with the people who are doing the work on your property and figure out what the best practice should be to avoid disturbing that area. If it's, you know, caution taping it off, if it's red tagging it, whatever it is, but think of a practice that you can use to not disturb those areas. Also, you want to avoid ground disturbances, rototilling, disking, getting tractors in there, really disturbing the soil becomes a problem because you will awaken those nasty invasives. One way that I truly, truly recommend is to just mow or trim vegetation. I'm also a true believer, and you'll probably hear this in other speakers, is to create islands of brush. Not underneath the canopy, but that's separate from the canopy, so that the brush is not contiguous. What you don't want is a wick. You want vegetation to be separated, so if it does catch on fire, it's not going to catch, you know, your tree or other bushes on fire. So if you can just remember, she talked about islands, like, you know, that works. It really works, and we've used it in our community many, many times. So you want to surround your house with landscaping that's less likely to burn. And again, to reiterate, that's usually natives. This is a Patrolla Valley Ranch, for example. And Blue Oaks. Sorry. This is off West Ridge. And the top one is Blue Oaks, and the bottom one is off Apache. And I think these are truly beautiful landscapes. They are native, and I have been to both of these places and seen lots of quail, and I've even seen turkeys on that top picture. So what they're doing seems to be working, and the animals feel very comfortable in these settings. So I think it's really important to make sure that you have the appropriate amount of fire safety around your home. It will save your home, and if you can, once you're done with your fuel reduction around your house, if you can maybe focus your attention to your house, because it really is a two-pronged approach. If you have a wood-shaped roof, or if you have a lot of vents you know, that are vulnerable to embers, it doesn't matter how much fuel reduction you do, your house will be vulnerable.
PhD candidate in biology at Stanford. He's currently a fifth-year PhD candidate where he studies wildlife behavior and conservation. He does his research at Jasper Ridge. And he grew up in Southern California, but has been interested in California ecosystems and mammalian conservation for a long time.
I want to start out with saying that, you know, any of us who take care of properties, we have a lot of options. And these options can be the way we plant and take care of our landscape can provide really amazing habitat for wildlife. And some of those options can be really great choices for fire management. And some of those for fire management aren't necessarily great for wildlife and vice versa. But what I'm hoping to talk about today is a little bit of the overlap where the choices that are both great for wildlife and fire management. And To start and to sort of go over what Denise mentioned was that habitat is varied and different species have vastly different needs on a heterogeneous landscape. That some species require large amounts of space and others much less. That that not only do different species have different requirements from each other, but even species within a single species will have different requirements across different seasons, across different times of day. So for example, rabbits really like to have open areas where there are low vegetation, where they feed, but they are often, or they're rarely found too far away from dense vegetation where they'll escape if faced with a predator. So it's there's a lot of benefit to having a wide variety of landscape, but at the same time, not all landscapes created equally. There are some points of the landscape which are really important and unique. For example, riparian corridors, areas where there's water or streams. These areas tend to be really productive areas, both for animals to find food and shelter and water, but also to move along these areas because they tend to be unobstructed. And so that's an important thing to think about that I'll mention a little bit more in a moment. One of the greatest difficulties for wildlife at the moment is fragmentation. The idea being that we have what used to be large, continuous areas of unadulterated landscape now have homes and roads and shopping centers placed in the middle, and it isolates little patches. Sometimes those patches are big, like state parks, or smaller, like Peninsula Open Space Trust lands or Jasper Ridge. But one of the most important aspects of this landscape is the connectivity between these different patches. And the choices that we make in our backyards and in our homes can really influence whether or not species will be able to utilize those areas to move from one patch to another. So that connectivity is really important, not just to allow species to move from one area to another, but because there are so many interactions between species. An example that I think is really important and interesting that is in our backyard is there are sent from three species. The first is this bacteria, Borrelia burgdorferi, and this bacteria is responsible for Lyme disease. As many of you probably know, a very serious disease in humans. And this bacteria doesn't just live out in the landscape by itself, it lives inside the tissues in the gut of ticks. And these ticks are interesting in that they take many different meals through their lifetime on different hosts, and they often feed on lizards. These western fence lizards, it turns out, has a protein in their blood that's believed to kill the Lyme disease that's in the tick, as some of you may also know. So in the East Coast, where there's a 50% or somewhere on that order, especially in the Northeast, incidence of Lyme disease in ticks. On the West Coast, or in California, especially in this area, we have somewhere between 1% and 2% of rates of infection of these ticks, and in part that's because of this interaction with the protein in this western fence lizard. So this is important because there are all kinds of interactions. Like the tick takes a blood meal, it attaches to the lizard and takes blood from it like a parasite, and while it's ingesting that blood has a protein which kills the bacteria inside the tick. So there are many, many kinds of interactions that we both understand, and some of them are quite phenomenal and much more complex than this. But the choices that we make in our backyards really influence the presence of these lizards and all the species that rely on them and a host of other species. One of the other important things to think about when we're talking about wildlife and our landscape is sort of a scale-based question, and that is different organisms require different amounts of space. Birds are flying maybe great distances and stopping over in areas like this and looking to native vegetation for food at the right time of the year when they're here. But smaller organisms are obviously using smaller areas to this extent where even just planting a few native plants in our backyards can bring in native pollinators and insects, butterflies, and be incredibly important for these populations. So I think you know, we have a lot of power in that we can really leverage these landscapes to help wildlife in a variety of different ways. And I think another opportunity that we have is we can think about our landscapes in a broader context. We can identify high value features to our landscape. So serpentine areas, some outcrops that might be around here that contain serpentine soils and rocks could be really useful. I know sometimes they're covered up because they're not as attractive and the plants that grow on them are very specific. And so we cover them in sod and grow ornamental plants. But it could be also really important to keep a few of those places, if not all of them, for places where lizards and other reptiles can sun and bask, as well as for native serpentine plants, which we're incredibly lucky to have such a soil around, and also riparian areas, and really leverage these waterways and help species use these as corridors. I wanted to come back for a moment and just mention that out of these options, one of our options is to sort of lead really dense and thick habitat. And this dense habitat can provide habitat, but it can also severely impinge movement. Like Denise mentioned, this landscape used to be much more open, and wildlife really need to be able to move from one space to another, especially along riparian corridors where natives, or I should say invasives, can grow and take over. And a lot of these invasives suck up, they grow, they take a lot of the water, but then they die off and they leave dry biomass, which is essentially tinder for when fire comes, as opposed to a lot of native species, which are able to maintain some living tissue throughout the year. Another issue is that when this heavy vegetation is close to homes, it's a haven for pests, and it's also a ladder for pests to get into ducts and vents, and they're able to take over and invade our homes. And an unfortunate aspect of that, aside from people not wanting pests in their homes, is that some of the poisons that we use to kill those pests drive the pests, once they're poisoned, outside, and then they're eaten by other native wildlife, which then become poisoned by the same toxins. Additionally, I know there are some disadvantages from things that look green, ornamentals like ivy. They look like the sea of green, but actually there's a high amount of dry material underneath that area, which is really hard to landscape and becomes a nice place for pests, especially close to home where there might be other trash or those kinds of resources around. So that can also be pretty deleterious. So keeping vegetation away from the home is both good for fire and as well as wildlife. The opposite end of that spectrum is disking or complete tilling of the land, which is destructive in a variety of ways. One, the land becomes, because it's not covered in any vegetation, it's warmer, it loses its moisture more quickly. Sometimes, depending on how the process is done, there could be hard pans, so the water doesn't seep into the soil as well, which creates more erosion. And another big issue with these areas that would be great to take a moment to talk about, and I think Denise also mentioned, is that invasive plants will take advantage of these areas, are able to grow incredibly quickly. They don't provide a lot of forage beneficial. And in doing so, they edge out the native plants, and they die back and then leave a bunch of dry material, which again is not good for the animals who are looking for plants and not good for fire as well. And another opportunity are snags or dead tree limbs and that sort of thing. I think they're really important and really great, and I think just to echo the sentiment that they can exist and they're really important to exist for wildlife. But the issue is maybe clearing enough space around them so that they're not continuous with just covered in sort of a woody and dry plant material. And so last, I just wanted to mention a few sources for native plants and further information. And Actera and the Arrastradero Preserve have a lot of great programs. I see someone from Actera is here, which is great. The local California Native Plant Society has great information and can also be a source for plants. They have a magazine called Comanche, which last issue dealt with fire and native plants, which is a fantastic issue. Yerba Buena Nursery is great for native plants, and Las Palitas Nursery is online, though they mostly sell to Southern California. They have a lot of really great information about landscaping for fire, firescaping and fire safe landscaping. So thanks.